So, hello guys. In this very short session, I'm going to talk about fungal rhinosinusitis because we all know that the fungal infection is the flavor of the season. And so I strongly feel that in the upcoming exam, they will talk something about fungus. Now, I've done a lot of videos talking about mucormycosis, the black fungus. You must have seen those videos also. But that is not the only fungus in the nasal cavity. We have five important fungal infections in the nasal cavity. Five funguses. So, which are these five funguses in the nasal cavity? One is aspergillosis. Second is fulminant fungal sinusitis. Now, this can be acute as well as chronic. Next, we have mucormycosis. Now, this one is important, mucormycosis. Because it can be orbital or cerebral. Orbital or cerebral mucormycosis. And then we have granulomatous fungal sinusitis. And the last one, which is actually the most important, is allergic fungal sinusitis. So you can see that these are the five important funguses or type of fungal disease of the nose and the sinuses that you have to know about. Out of this, the first two, that is aspergillosis and fulminant fungal sinusitis, acute as well as chronic, they are caused by Aspergillus fumigatus. Now, this is also called the yellow fungus, incidentally. So you hear this yellow fungus is a lot nowadays. So this is that yellow fungus. Mucormycosis is either caused by rhizopus or a mucor. Both can cause rhizopus or a mucor. And this is a potential question. Granulomatous, on the other hand, is caused by Aspergillus flavus mainly. And allergic fungal sinusitis is most commonly caused by bipolaris. Now, so this is the first thing that you need to know, that which are the fungal disease of the nose and the sinuses, and which are the funguses causing these diseases. Now, if you ask me, out of these five important fungal disease of the nose and the sinuses, fungal rhinosinusitis, which is the most common one? Now, most common is aspergillosis. Aspergillosis is the most common fungal disease of the nose and the sinus. Now, see, if you notice that both this first and the second one, they are both caused by Aspergillus fumigatus, the same fungus, and the area is the same, which is nose and the sinuses, then why does some people have aspergillosis, which is the most common, and some have fulminant fungal sinusitis, which is a more dangerous fungus? Now, this largely depends on the immunity of the person. Immunity means whether the patient is immunocompetent or immunocompromised. Now, if the patient is immunocompetent, then it is aspergillosis. So, this is immunocompetent person. No diabetes, no steroid, no COVID, nothing. So, these are immunocompetent person. they tend to have aspergillosis. So what is the difference? And this one, I told you, fulminant fungal sinusitis is seen in immunocompromised like diabetes. This is seen in like diabetics which are immunocompromised, as we understand. So what is the difference it makes whether the patient is immunocompetent or immunocompromised, if the fungus is the same? See, in an immunocompetent person, this same fungus behaves like a invasive fungal disease, and in an immunocompromised person. But in an immunocompetent person, it's a non-invasive fungal disease. So if I talk about, say, aspergillosis, it is the most common fungal disease of the nose caused by Aspergillus fumigatus. We know this. Now this is seen in, as I said, immunocompetent person. And non-invasive fungal disease. Right. So what happens is, because it is non-invasive, the fungus goes into the nose, but does not invade the tissue of the nose. So it collects in the nose. The fungus will collect in the nose to form a fungal ball. Now this is very important. A ball of fungus called aspergilloma. So this term is important for you, the term called aspergilloma. So it's like a foreign body in the nasal cavity, and this foreign body like thing is made up of fungus, which is a compilation of the fungus. So it will cause the nasal obstruction, bleed from the nose, anosmia, loss of sense of smell because it will block the nose. Pain maybe. So like a simple foreign body, and rarely also discharge from the nasal cavity. And diagnosis is very simple. You do anterior rhinoscopy. If you do anterior rhinoscopy, you can see a fungal ball in the nose. And if there's a doubt, you can do a KOH staining or any other stain. You can do a staining to confirm. And once you have confirmed, what do? You do a surgical excision of the fungal ball. So you do surgical excision. So that's all you have to do. So note this, very important, that antifungals are not so important here. Just a simple surgical excision is enough if it is aspergillosis fungal ball. Because the fungus has not gone into the tissue, it is non-invasive. This word non-invasive is very important. Because it is non-invasive, it does not invade the blood in the tissues, and therefore, just removal of the fungal ball should be enough. But the other two conditions, these two, mucormycosis and fulminant fungal sinusitis, these two are very similar. They are caused by different funguses. Fulminant fungal sinusitis, I told you, is caused by Aspergillus fumigatus. And mucormycosis either rhizopus or a mucor, but both these fungal diseases, they behave very similarly. So mucormycosis, which is called the black fungus, incidentally you know this now, although that's a misnomer, and fulminant fungal sinusitis, which can be acute and chronic. Now, I'll not tell you I'll tell you that mucormycosis, as you know, is caused by a rhizopus or a mucor, whereas this one is caused by Aspergillus fumigatus. Now, rest of the points are very, very similar. So both are seen in young diabetics, both are invasive. If you remember, the other one, the previous one was non-invasive, so these are both invasive. They spread very fast. They cause a lot of complications. And that's important. They cause a lot of complications. And both MRI and staining, because staining will confirm KH or other staining, can be done, PA staining can be done, and other stainings. And MRI will show you the spread of the disease. And in both, we give amphotericin B as the main drug plus surgical debridement. And the surgery of choice is functional endoscopic sinus surgery, which is called FES. Functional endoscopic sinus surgery, FES, can be done or should be done in both of them. So please notice that everything is same except that the fungus is different. So between mucormycosis and rhinocerebral and fulminant fungal rhinosinusitis, the two basic differences are: one, that the funguses are same, that's why the names are different, and second, mucormycosis is an angio-invasive fungus. So this is invasive, but this one is also angio-invasive. That means it involves the invades the blood vessels, and that's a very important point. Now, because it is angio-invasive, the mucormycosis, it does two things. It will block the blood vessel, because it goes into the blood vessel, and if the blood vessel gets blocked, it causes ischemia. And if the ischemia, it can cause necrosis. So mucormycosis is a necrotizing disease, and necrosis causes black tissue and discharge. So because the tissue becomes black due to necrosis, and that's why the name black fungus comes. That's why the name is black fungus. So very, very important why it's called black fungus. So the fungus is not black. The color of the pathogen is not black. It's called black fungus because the tissue becomes black, and that's because of, as I said, necrosis. So it's a necrotizing disease. Necrotizing disease. And the other thing, it will mix with the blood and then spread with the blood. So it's very fast. So it spreads fast. So it spreads to two areas. One is orbit and cranial cavity. So what will happen in the orbit and the cranial cavity? It will cause necrosis in the orbit, and it will cause necrosis. For the same reason, it's a necrotizing disease, so it will cause necrosis in the orbit and necrosis in the cranial cavity, and these are very, very dangerous conditions. And that's why this disease is so common, so important, they talk about this so much nowadays. Now, because mucormycosis causes orbital spread and cranial spread very, very commonly, it is called orbito cerebral mucormycosis or rhino orbito cerebral mucormycosis. ROCM is a very commonly used term. ROCM stands for rhino orbito cerebral mucormycosis, sometimes called ROCZ. Z is zygomycosis, rhino orbito cerebral zygomycosis. So this mnemonics, this short form, you should be able to talk about. And the drug of choice is very important. And the dose of amphotericin B could be an important MCQ. It is 1 to 5 milligram per kg body weight per day. Normally, but for orbital spread and cranial spread, the quantity or the dose will increase. So if it is orbital spread or kernel spread, the dose and the quantity will increase. So very, very important, mucormycosis, black fungus. And I made a complete video only on mucormycosis in COVID patients. So if you want, you can look up in the YouTube, and it has all the information that you need, because it's basic, it's only on mucormycosis, nothing else. So it has a huge amount of information. Now the third one, which is the fourth one, this granulomatous, is not important. So we'll skip this. Just remember the pathogen. But the last one is important: allergic fungal sinusitis caused by bipolaris. So this is our last fungus, allergic fungal sinusitis, and it's caused by bipolaris, which is the main pathogen. See, patient is allergic to the fungus, and that's why this is type 1 hypersensitivity. This is type 1 hypersensitivity. But what is most important here, that there is a criteria for diagnosis, and this is what they ask. To diagnose this disease, there are 5 criteria. And you will notice that these 5 criteria are so opposite, almost opposite of these mucormycosis and the fulminant fungal sinusitis. Almost opposite. Like this is seen in immunocompetent person again. Not immunocompromised, it is seen in immunocompetent person. And so no diabetes, no sugar, no steroid, and nothing of the sort. No evidence of invasion. So there is no evidence of invasion. So it's a non-invasive fungal. The previous ones, they are both invasive. This is non-invasive fungal disease. There should be evidence of allergy. Because it is allergic fungal sinusitis, so there has to be either IgE raised, eosinophilia, or RAST test should be positive. So some evidence of allergy has to be there. Then nasal discharge must have fungus. So if you take a nasal discharge and culture it, it must go fungus. Or if you stain it, it must show fungus. So there should be some evidence that nasal discharge must have fungus. But even without staining, even without culture, if you experience, just by looking at the nasal discharge, you can make out that this is a fungal discharge. Because it's a very typical look. And this look is described as, this is a very important point, it's called peanut butter. Peanut buttery, butter-like discharge. So this nasal discharge looks like a peanut butter. It's a very, very, very important point. And the last point of criteria for diagnosis is that CT scan is either double density scan, shows double density, or heterogeneous. So these are the 5 diagnostic criteria for allergic fungal sinusitis. Now let me explain the last one. See, if I ask you, how does this patient present? What is the presentation? Then presentation is nasal polyp with calcium deposits. This is how it looks like. So you see polyp in the nose. You see the polyp in the nose, but inside the polyp, there are deposits of calcium. So nasal polyp with calcium deposits can be seen in this patient. Right. So when you take a CT scan, you see 2 densities. This is soft tissue density. And this is bone density. Calcium is bone-like density, and so there are 2 densities, and that's why it's called double density scan. So this is a CT scan that shows you double densities. So this is a CT scan of penis. So can you see these white things? These are calcium and rest of it is soft tissue volume. So you can see that soft tissue density as well as the calcium density, and that's why this particular scan is called a double density scan, also called heterogeneous. Hetero means more than one. So they are heterogeneous, more than one densities, and that's why double density scan. It's a very important CT scan. It was asked 2 years back. They had shown similar CT scan and they'd ask you what is this, and one of the choices given was double density scan, and that was the correct answer. And what is the treatment? See, it's caused due to allergy, remember? So we give steroid mainly, plus wash the nose inside, wash with antifungal solution. Plus FES, functional endoscopic sinus surgery. So these are the three things you have to do in this patient. You have to give steroid, you have to wash with antifungal solution, and you have to do a surgery to remove this polyp like thing, FES. So this is a very brief encounter where we deal with fungal sinusitis, which are of 5 types, right? So we'll close this session here, and I hope this was useful. I thought that because fungus is the flavor of the day, nasal fungus, so I thought I must discuss this because it's a potential question from the exam paper. So with this, I thank you for joining. I hope you guys are doing very well. Please study very, very hard. Your exam date is out already, the central exams. So I'm pretty sure you're working very, very hard on it. And since you cannot go out of the house, you have to stay inside. So this is the best thing you can do. You can keep studying. That's what you can do. Keep doing. Okay. With this, I take your leave. God bless you and take a very good care of yourselves. Thank you, guys.